Okay.
Okay, welcome back, everybody. This is the fourth and the last part of our wonderful lecture series for the month of October. So our speaker, Ilia Itenberg from Sorbonne University, will continue his talk. And I guess the promise today is to talk about the topology of real algebraic surfaces and areas in K3 surfaces.
Thank you very much. So indeed, unfortunately, it's the last talk of the series, so I have to make some choices and decide what I really will present today. So indeed, I'll try to speak about topology of real algebraic surfaces first, and then we'll, I hope, come to this discussion of areas in K3 surfaces. So topology of real algebraic surfaces. So as I said two days ago at the end of the talk, we still have something to discuss in the case of curves, but let me switch to a discussion of surfaces, and then if we have time, I will say a couple of words about complex orientations of curves that Grisha already mentioned yesterday. So first of all, let me indicate this extremely important relation between the topology of curves in surfaces and the topology of surfaces. I'm still speaking about real objects. So if we have a real algebraic curve in IP2, so it is given by a homogeneous polynomial in two variables. So let's assume that the degree is even. Degree is 2k. So it's d and d is 2k. And we can consider, as we already did, the real point set of this curve in IP2 and the complex point set of this curve in CP2. So now what we can do, since the degree is even, meaning that the class of the complex point set in CP2, the homology class, is divisible by 2, so we can consider a ramified covering of CP2. So I will denote the complex surface we obtained by Y. So ramified covering, so this covering is ramified at the complex point set of our curve. So it's ramified double covering. So we get a complex surface Y, but since our curve was real, so the real structure, so this involution of complex conjugation acting in CP2 can be lifted to Y and even in two different ways. So let's see it on the level of equations. So how to write down an equation for Y in some appropriate space. So we introduce a new variable, so it's x3, and the equation will be x3 squared equal to f of x0, x1, x2. So now this equation, so a polynomial defining our curve, is not homogeneous, but it has a well-defined set of zeros in a weighted projective space. So just consider the weights 1, 1, 1 for the first two variables and the weight k for the last variable, and you get a set of zeros of this equation in this weighted projective space. And well, this is our y. Right? And now we see that if F is real, we have two liftings of the conjugation acting in CP2. So we can decide that, so the first lifting is like this. So we send this tuple x0, x1, x2, x3 to x0 bar, x1 bar, x2 bar, and x3 bar. So this is the first option. And the second option is, well, I want to lift the complex conjugation, so I don't have choice for the first three variables. But what can I do for the last one? I can just multiply it by r. Is it okay? Or just mine? So how does it? So I should just put minus, sir. Okay. So we have these two liftings, and what are the, so we have two real surfaces, so two real structures on Y, and what is the real point set of the resulting real surface for the first choice, so for this one? Well, so we see that over, so once again, so we have this real point set of our curve, which divides AP2 into halves, as we discussed 2 days ago. So the part where our polynomial is positive and the part where our polynomial is negative, assuming that the polynomial is chosen in such a way that outside of all the ovals, the values are negative. And so we see that for each point, so this is RP2 plus, if for each point of this path, we have two inverse images, we have two choices for the last coordinate, right? So what you should think about the real path of this surface is that this real path is kind of double of RP2 plus. So we have two copies of RP2 plus and they are glued along the boundary. So in my picture, what you will get two spheres and one torus. And for AP2 minus, what happens is that if you consider the other real structure, the second real structure, then the real point set lives above the AP2 minus, and it's also a kind of double of AP2 minus. It's a little bit more tricky in the case of AP2 minus because AP2 minus is not orientable, so it's not just two copies glued together. In the interior of AP2 minus, so over the interior we have double covering, which is not necessarily trivial. Okay, so this means that the topology of real algebraic curves in AP2 is, at least if the degree is even, is closely related to the topology of such double planes. In particular, if we are interested in the early characteristic of AP2 plus, and remember that the early characteristic of AP2 plus was the number of even ovals minus the number of odd ovals. So this early characteristic is just one half of the early characteristic of the real part of Y where we made the first choice of the lifting, so, right? Because as I said, this real path is just double, two copies of AP2 plus glued together along the bound. So if you're interested in the early characteristic of AP2 plus, you can do this procedure and try to understand what happens with the early characteristic of the real path of this real algebraic surface. And the Gudkov-Rochlin congruence I mentioned at the end of the talk 2 days ago becomes a corollary of Rochlin's congruence for maximal real algebraic surfaces. So in fact, so what happens if you start with a maximal curve, then for one choice of lifting, the resulting real surface will be maximal. And for the other, in fact, it will be almost maximal, but not maximal. And so for this first choice, the real surface will not be maximal, but for the second one, it will be. And one can apply Rochlin modulus 16 congruence for the early characteristic of this the resulting real algebraic surface. And so the congruence tells you that if your real algebraic surface is maximal, then the early characteristic of the real path is congruent to the signature modulus 16. And so applying this congruence to the second lifting, to the second lifting of the real structure, in the case of maximal curve, you get a Gudkov-Rochlin congruence. So another example is that for of this relations between topology of real algebraic curves and topology of real algebraic surfaces. So you can consider, for example, commisatia inequalities for the resulting real algebraic surfaces. So this commisatia inequalities give you another information about the early characteristic of the real path. And so the early characteristic for any of these two liftings, so it's a general effect about real algebraic projective surfaces, that the early characteristic of the real path is at most H11 of the complex point set of our surface. So this Hodge number in the middle of the Hodge diamond and is at least 2 minus H11. And so once again, if you rewrite these inequalities in terms of the initial curve, so these inequalities will give you what is called Petrovsky inequalities. So of course, it's still an information about P minus N, the early characteristic of AP2 plus, or if you prefer, you can interpret this information as information about early characteristic for AP2 minus. And so it's at most 3/2 K times K minus 1 plus 1. And the second inequality will give you N minus P is at most 3/2 K times K minus 1, where K is the half of the degree. So an exercise, since I'm still planning to give some exercises, try to construct for any positive K a curve for which, for example, the first Petrovsky inequality becomes an equality. So try to show sharpness of this first Petrovsky inequality. So exercise, show the sharpness. of well, it's a little bit easier in the case of, the first inequality of the first inequality, first Petrovsky inequality. For any positive k. A hint: you can use the rational curve constructed by Grisha during the first lecture. So you can use this simple Harnack rational curve. So the picture was like this. And you have some number of nodes inside, some number of nodes outside.
There's a question, Ilya, on the chat.
Yes.
Ali Ulaş Özgür asking, are there these inequalities valid for M curves or?
No. This inequalities are for any non-singular curve of degree to k. So for this, you don't need maximality. So the congruence is in the maximal case and commissati inequalities. So it's a general fact about real algebraic projective real algebraic surfaces. So these inequalities are valid for any smooth curve of degree d in AP2. D equal to 2k in AP2. And so I said, try to use this rational curve constructed by Grisha to show the sharpness of the first Petrovsky inequality. So this inequality is sharp for any k.
And okay. The evenness was to make sure all the components of that curve is oval and it just splits the.
I'm sorry?
The evenness. So because we are working with this even degrees here, right?
Yes.
So everything works here, even degree.
For this restriction, so it's important that the degree is even, because that's exactly what I'm trying to underline, that these restrictions in the case of curves are related to the corresponding restrictions in the case of surfaces, and to go to the surface case, I take this ramified double covering of CP2, so ramified along the complex point set of our curve. And to do it, I need to assume that the degree is even. So this ramified double covering exists if and only if the degree is even. Okay, so this was, was kind of motivating considerations. And probably the last thing I wanted to say about this inequalities, that in fact, commissati inequalities are not very difficult to prove. So Rochlin congruence is a little bit more delicate. It requires a little bit more work. But the commissati inequalities, you can prove in the following way. So you can, to prove commissati inequalities, So to prove commissati inequalities, so one can consider the involution induced by the real structure on the second homology group of the surface with integer coefficients. So we have involution. So this second homology group is a lattice. So there is an intersection form on it, and you can consider two eigen sublattices, so the invariant part and the anti-invariant part. And for each of the parts, So for example, for the invariant part, you have the number of positive squares of the intersection form and the number of negative squares. So you have these two quantities for each of the two paths. So you have four quantities. So these quantities can be calculated. And in fact, what is used in the calculation, so in the result of the calculation, these are just some quantities associated to the complex surface. And what is used from the real structure is the early characteristic. So it can be calculated in terms of some invariance of the complex surface and the early characteristic of the real path. And then the Kemisati inequalities, so there are two inequalities, and so these inequalities are just the fact that the number of negative squares in the invariant path and the number of negative squares is anti-invariant path, this both numbers are non-negative. So the number of squares cannot be, of quadratic form cannot be negative, and these are just Kemisati inequalities. So what I mean that you can prove this Kemisati inequality just playing with these two eigen sublattices and calculating them, the ranks and the this signature of the restriction of intersection form of the sublattice. Okay, so now let's speak in more details about algebraic surfaces. In RP3. So these double planes were algebraic surfaces in a weighted projective space, but let's go to the standard projective space to CP3. Let's consider real surfaces in CP3. Well, I will call them algebraic surfaces in RP3. So one can try to analyze them in a way similar to the one we considered 2 days ago in the case of curves. So such a surface is defined by a polynomial now in four variables. So it's a real homogeneous polynomial. Of let's denote the degree again d, and one can analyze what happens if the degree is small. So we want to understand still the topology of something. So the first object to investigate is the topology of the real point set of our surface. So in the case of surfaces, already the questions about the topology of this real point set itself are non-trivial. But of course, as in the case of curves, we can consider the topological pair RP3 Rx. I'm sorry, something happened with the light. Yes. So we can try to understand the topology of this topological pair. And so as in the case of curves, you can analyze possible topologies in small degree. So in the case of curves, small, so the meaning of small was smaller than 6. So it was easy to go, I hope you remember, until the degree 6, and starting from degree 6, it becomes complicated. Here for surfaces, the analog of 6 is 4. So it's quite easy to go until the degree 3. So, well, d equal to 1 is clear. D equal to 2, once again, you can analyze what happens with the quadratic real quadratic forms. So it's also easy. The degree 3 is slightly more complicated, but still relatively easy. So once again, you can play with Bezout type considerations as we did in the case of curves. Try to understand what happens with cubic surfaces, but starting from degree 4, it becomes really complicated. And in fact, there is a reason why the difficulty in the consideration of curves of degree 6 is more or less similar to the difficulty to consider surfaces of degree 4. In fact, in the both cases, so if speaking about curves of degree 6, we think about this ramified double covering. So this ramified double covering is a K3 surface.
Would you explain that not quite 4, degree 4 and degree 6 are similar?
Sorry?
Could you explain that remark by degree 4 and degree
6? Yeah, that's exactly what I'm saying. So in the case of curves of degree 6, so if you have a smooth curve of degree 6 in CP2, the ramified double covering, so this double covering ramified along the complex point set of our curve is a K3 surface. So the questions about curves of degree 6 are, in fact, questions about K3 surfaces. And similarly, and a smooth quartic surface in P3 and CP3 is a K3 surface. So once again, we are speaking about, we are trying to understand something about the topology of real K3 surfaces. The polarizations are different, but still the questions are about K3 surfaces. So
are those the maximal degrees that you know the classifications that complete classifications?
Yes, so the complete classifications are, in the case of curves, as Grisha said, are known until the degree 7, but 7 is odd, so it's difficult to compare to the case of surfaces. So the maximal even degree for which the complete classification is known is degree 6. And sure. In the case of surfaces, the degree 4 is the maximal degree for which the complete classification is known. And in fact, in the case of curves, one can consider some other more advanced classifications, and they are also known in degree 6. As in the case of surfaces, one can also consider some more advanced classifications. They are known up to degree 4, but almost nothing is known in degree 5. So, okay, let's try to ask the most naive question about the topology of Rx. So, what was the most basic fact about the topology of curves? So this was definitely the Harnack inequality, right? So this inequality telling you that the number of connected components of the real point set of your curve is at most the genus plus one. So it's reasonable to ask what is an analog of a Harnack inequality for surfaces. So this question is known as a Harnack problem, because Harnack tried to ask the question. And well, in fact, Harnack really asked what can be the precise question asked by Harnack was what can be the maximal possible number of connected components of the real point set of a surface of a given degree, or let's say smooth surface of given degree in RP3. So it turns out that this question is extremely complicated. And so in degree 5, as I said, we don't know topological classification of smooth surfaces, but in fact, we even don't know the maximal possible number of connected components. So in degree 4, we know many classifications. So this topological classification, what is called rigid isotopic classifications, which is more advanced. But for surface of degree 5, we even don't know what is the maximal possible number of connected components. So it's known that this number is at most 25. And there are examples with 23 connected components. So there's still a gap between 23 and 25. But there is another way to generalize Harnack inequality.
This is for degree 5?
Yes, yes, for degree 5. So for degree 5, so if the degree is 5, the maximal possible number, so maximal possible number of connected components of Rx, so this number is between 25 and 23. So this is known, but what is the exact value? We don't know.
Did you say degree 4 is completely known? Maximum?
Yeah, for degree 4, in a sense, everything is known. all the topological information is obtained.
What's that number for degree four?
Sorry?
What's that number for degree four?
You mean the number maximal number of connected components? It's 10. Yeah. But we are coming to this exercise. It will be an exercise. Let me formulate a generalization of Harnack inequality. So a generalization of the Harnack inequality is so-called Smith-Thom inequality. So what is this inequality? So instead of consider the number of connected components of the real point set, we consider the total Betti number with Z2 coefficients of the real point set. So this is a sum over all I of dimensions of Hi of Rx with Z2 coefficients. So what is called the total Z2 Betti number. And the inequalities tells you that this number is bounded from above by the total Betti number of the complex point set. So exercise, see what happens in the case of curves, and you will see that in the case of curves, you get back the Harnack inequality. Thinking about Harnack inequality, we have an impression that this inequality is about the number of connected components, but of course you can interpret this inequality in terms of the double of the number of connected components, which is the total Betti number of the real path. This Smith-Thom inequality can be proved in various ways. In particular, one can use what is called Smith exact sequence. This is a corollary of this Smith exact sequence. So, of considerations related to the Smith exact sequence. So, let us discuss in more details the case of quartics, because as I said, it's the first interesting case. So the Smith-Thom inequality tells you that the total Betti number of the real path will be at most the total Betti number of the classification of the complex point set. And well, so you see what is important in this inequality is that we are bounding some topological characteristic of the real point set in terms of some characteristic which depends only on the topology of the complexification, meaning that it depends, since we are speaking about smooth surfaces, it depends only on the degree. So the right hand side you can calculate in terms of the degree, and so what you will get for degree four, the total Betti number of the complex point set is 24, so you get this this upper bound. And now you can try to understand what are possible maximal quartics. So maximal once again means for curves, the meaning of maximal or M was maximal in the sense of Harnack inequality. Now it's maximal in the sense of Smith-Thom inequality. So maximal means that the total Betti number of the real path is equal to the total Betti number of the complexification. So There are three possible topologies for maximal quartics. And so the topologies are like this. So you can have a sphere with 10 handles and the sphere. You can have a sphere with 6 handles and 5 spheres. And you can have a sphere with 2 handles and 9 spheres.
Oh, this configuration is very similar to the degree 6 curves.
Very good.
Yeah.
Very good. This is, of course, an important observation that these topologies you should compare with the topology of the Harnack curve, of the Gudkov curve. And of Hilbert curve.
What's the proof of this, that you have only these three?
Well, so I'll come to this question in a minute. Let me just to finish the description of this picture, show you that it's not just a similarity. So if you consider the second choice of the lifting for the real structure. So if you consider the lifting such that the real point set of this double plane is above RP2 minus, in the case of Harnack curve, you will get indeed a sphere with 10 handles and one sphere. Just look at RP2 IP2 minus, so, and think about this procedure of doubling. So in this case, above the non-orientable component, you will have a non-trivial covering. So you will get a sphere with 10 handles and one sphere. So this one sphere is above this most interior oval and so on. So. You get exactly this this topology in all the three cases. So now coming back to Selman's question. So first of all, one can play with Bezout theorem, considerations of eigen sublattices in second homology of our surfaces. So this invariant sublattice and anti-invariant sublattice and considerations of numbers of positive and negative squares in both of them to exclude some number of cases. But then the crucial point to exclude other cases will be the Rocklin congruence. So you see, the Rocklin congruence tells you that in the maximal case, the early characteristic of the real path should be congruent modulo 16 to the signature. So the signature is minus 16. So it should be congruent to minus 16, modulo 16. And this excludes many possibilities for the number. Here you see there is a number of kinetic components and the first Betti number. And what I'm saying that for this couple, there are only three possibilities because of the Rocklin congruence in the maximal case.
So you can compute the signature of these different possibilities.
I'm speaking about this. Once you fix the number of connected components and the first Betti number, you know the early characteristic of the real path. And then you compare this early characteristic with the signature of the complexification, which is minus 16. And in the maximal case, since we are looking at the maximal case, it should be, so you should get same number modulo 16. Okay, So in particular, you know that it's impossible to, in the first case, to increase the number of connected components by one, because in this case you will get three connected components, and the first basic number will be twice 9, and the Euler characteristic is not minus 16 modulus 16. Okay. What I said about the signatures of sublatences, so this is important to exclude the situation where the handles are distributed among different connected components of the real point set. Because in principle, one could imagine that, for example, in the first case, in this one, the 10 handles are distributed somehow between two connected components. But this is forbidden by the consideration of this game with positive and negative squares in the invariant sublattice, because each connected component of the real part represents a class in the invariant sublattice. And you control the squares because the square is minus the Euler characteristic of the component. Okay, so now an exercise. Exercise I promised. Prove that the maximal possible number of connected component, maximal possible number of connected components of the real point set of a smooth quartic surface, so the number of connected components, is at most 10. So in fact, you have all the information required for to prove such an inequality. So you can use, so the hint, you can use the Smith-Thoma inequality and one of Kamisati inequalities. And once you use them, the last step in the proof will be to use the Rochlin congruence. So combining these three statements, you can prove that the number of components of a quartic surface is always at most 10. And in fact, this is indeed the maximal possible number. It's not very difficult to construct a quartic surface with 10 components. Okay, so now let me switch to a discussion of K3 surfaces. So as I said,
I use this calculation. What's the what restriction did you use in here to reduce to 10?
So I mean, what was the hint for this to prove this to prove this inequality? I said that you can use use Smith-Thoma inequality.
That's one, okay.
So this is the first one.
Yeah.
Kamisati inequalities.
That's about curves?
No, Kamisati inequalities was about surfaces. So Kamisati inequalities, so these are Kamisati inequalities, they are for surfaces.
Okay.
The corollary was for curves, so corollary was Petrovsky inequalities, but Kamisati inequalities is a statement about real algebraic surfaces. And so the last ingredient, so Kamisati inequalities, in fact, we will need only one of them. And the last ingredient is the Rochlin congruence.
Okay, thank you.
And so, as I said, since quartic surfaces are K3 surfaces, one can use standard techniques to study period spaces of polarized K3 surfaces and to deduce a lot of information, a lot of topological information about these surfaces. But now I'd like to discuss some more geometric information. So I'd like to discuss briefly in 15 remaining minutes our recent joint work with Grisha. So I'd like to discuss areas in K3 surfaces. So in particular, you can think about this question of areas in quartic surfaces. But more generally, so a K3 surface is a smooth, compact, simply connected complex surface with trivial canonical class. And so if we consider such a surface, so if X is a K3 surface, so on this surface, you have, let me denote it by omega, non-zero. So we pick a non-zero holomorphic two form, which nowhere, so this form nowhere vanishes. And so this form is defined up to multiplication by a non-zero complex constant. And choosing this constant in an appropriate way, we can assume, so we can assume that, so now I'm considering a real K3 surface. So my K3 surface is real, that is equipped with an anti-holomorphic involution. So with a real structure, so an anti-holomorphic involution C. And so we can assume that alpha, this is my notation for the real part of omega, is C invariant. And the imaginary part of omega is C anti-invariant. Once again, this expression one can assume means that multiplying omega by an appropriate non-zero constant, I can achieve this C invariance for the real part and at the same time C anti-invariance for the imaginary part. And so what I will be interested mainly in is this alpha, the real part of omega. So alpha is a closed real two form, which is not vanishing. Is not vanishing. And thus, first of all, defines an orientation of each connected component of Rx. And by the way, I'm sorry, I forgot to tell it when I discussed algebraic surfaces in IP3. So I promised to Selman to explain So to discuss this orientability questions concerning the real path. So coming back to surfaces, algebraic surfaces on IP3. So in particular, let's speak about quartic surfaces on IP3. So why in the case of even degree, the real paths are always orientable? Well, so if you have a surface, a smooth surface of even degree in IP3, so it is defined by a polynomial of even degree, and exactly as in the case of curves, this polynomial has a positive value, so well-defined values at any point of IP3. So there is a part of IP3 where the values are positive and the part of IP3 where the values are negative. And our surface separates these two regions, which are, of course, not necessarily connected. So this means that the real part of our surface is co-oriented. Just choose this co-orientation, you go from the negative part to the positive part, right? But since IP3 is orientable, the existence of such a co-orientation means that the real path is orientable, right? And it's a little bit more complicated, but not really complicated, but needs some additional considerations to show that if the degree is odd, then the real point set of our smooth surface in IP3 is necessarily non-orientable. So the real path is orientable if and only if the degree is even for a smooth surface in IP3. So in the odd case, one should work a little bit more, but it's not complicated. But in the even case, it's just an immediate corollary of the existence of such a co-orientation. Okay, so in particular, for quartic surfaces, the real path is orientable, but more generally, any K3, for any real K3 surface, the real path is orientable, and once you choose omega in such a way I described, alpha gives you an orientation of the real point set. In addition, alpha allows us to consider areas of connected components of X. So in addition, alpha allows us to consider areas of connected components of X for any connected component K of X. So K is a connected component. What can I do? I can integrate over K omega or alpha. It's the same. And well, I'd like this. In principle, I can consider signed areas as Grisha did, but for my statement, I will take the absolute value. So this is what is the area of K for me. So of course, this area depends on the choice of alpha. So alpha, in fact, is defined up to multiplication by a non-zero real number, meaning that this area is defined up to multiplication by a positive real number. So it's not very interesting to speak about the area of one component. But if I have several components, I can compare areas, because I can, of course, rescale alpha and consider other collection of areas, but this will just multiply all the areas by the same positive constant. So I can compare and say that the area of one component is bigger than the area of another component. This does not depend on the choice of alpha, right? And so the statement we proved with Grisha is as follows. So assume that X is a real K3 surface well now I will write some expression that I will need to explain once this expression is written. So admitting okay, so admitting a, what we call a non-contractible polarization. I will explain in a minute what does it mean. Look, polarization of genus which is positive. And say that Rx has I will need a notation for this number A, which is at least G connected components. Okay, so what do I mean by non-contractible polarization? So a polarization of genus G is just a linear system of a smooth real curve C in X, and C is smooth real of genus G. So the adjunction formula tells you in particular that the dimension of this linear system is G, and that the square of your curve is 2G minus 2. So sometimes when one speaks about a polarization, one just indicates to this number 2g minus 2, but I prefer to speak in terms of the genus. And non-contractible means that H1 of the real part of this curve is non-zero. Well, what I'm saying. The class of the real part of this curve is non-zero in the first homology group of the real part of the surface in Z2 coefficients. And so I prepared this statement because I was guessing that I will not have enough time to write it down. So now you have the complete statement. So the statement is this inequality. So as we have seen in the case of maximal quartics, so if I have some number of spherical components, I can have at most one non-spherical component of the real Poinsett. And if the polarization is non-contractible, there is exactly one. I should have a non-spherical component, because otherwise the class of the real part of RC will necessarily be zero. So I denote this component this non-spherical component by n. And so the statement is that the area of this component is sufficiently big comparing to the area of spherical components. And so here I used another convention. So I guess with my new convention for A, it should be plus one here. So you can take, yeah, so here I wrote A minus one, so okay, so it's a, okay, now it's okay. So you can have, take some number of spherical components and the sum of areas of this spherical components is at, well, smaller than the area of non-spherical components, meaning that the spherical components are, from the point of view of area, are small when you compare them to the area of a non-spherical component. And so my time is over, so let me just say it briefly that the key notion in the proof of the statement is an analog of simple Harnack curves Grisha described in his lectures. So one can introduce this notion of a simple Harnack curve on the real K3 surface. And as Grisha explained yesterday, so one can control the deformations of these curves quite well in terms of certain areas. And in addition, since the curves are simple Harnack, one can also control the degenerations of these curves along these deformations. And so playing with deformations of simple Harnack curves, one can prove such inequalities for areas. So what is important in the definition of a simple Harnack curve is this notion of complex orientation. So Grisha discussed yesterday. So if you have a separating real curve, so separating real curve means that the real point set divides the complex point set into halves. Once you have chosen one of the halves, you take the complex orientation of this this pattern. This complex orientation induces some orientation of the boundaries, so what we call complex orientation of the real path. So this complex orientation is defined up to total change of this orientation on all the components, because you can choose another half, and this will switch all the orientations to the positive orientation, to the opposite orientation. I'm sorry. So one can use some properties of simple Harnack curves Grisha discussed yesterday with respect to complex orientations to define an analog of simple Harnack curves on a K3 surface. And once again, playing with deformations of these simple Harnack curves, one can prove such an inequality. So this inequality is just an example of applications of example of possible applications of simple Harnack curves in the case of K3 surfaces. So sorry for being so long and for going over time.
We are almost on time, actually, a couple of minutes. Okay, thanks our speaker. Thank you for the great talk. Okay, so questions.
Remind me again why you only have one non-spherical component. That was that classification.
Well, it's not completely true that there is only always at most one non-spherical component. So there is one exception. So this exception is two tori. So it's possible to have two tori in the real part of a real gated surface, but in this case, there are no other components. But this is the only exception. And by the way, these two tori realize the same homology class in the second homology group of our surface. So how to see that it is impossible. So let me explain why it is impossible to have two connected components of genus at least two. And then this argument can be extended to deal with genus one, except the case of two tori, two homological tori. So if you have two connected components, each of which has genus at least two, so you consider the classes realized by this components in the second homology group of our surface. And these classes are invariant with respect to the conjugation, the real structure, because they're realized by components of the real path. And you can calculate the squares of these classes with respect to the intersection form. So the square will be minus the early characteristic. So this is always the case. So this is a general calculation. So for this, we don't need to assume that the genus is at least two, but if the genus of each component is at least two, it means that the squares, both squares are positive, right? So the early characteristic is negative, so the squares are positive. So we have two classes with positive squares, and these classes are orthogonal, right? Because these connected components do not intersect. And this is impossible because in the invariant path, you have only one positive square.
Orthogonal means they intersect once, algebraic, is that right?
No, orthogonal, the intersection is zero.
Zero, oh, I see.
No, so the classes are so orthogonal with respect to the intersection form. So the intersection is zero because they don't intersect, right? Okay. These two connected components do not intersect at all.
Then what?
Then you have two orthogonal classes with positive squares, meaning that the signature of the invariant path should be at least two and then something, right? So the number of positive squares should be at least two. And in fact, it is one.
Oh.
In the case of K3 surfaces, so the distribution of positive, so there are three positive squares in total. Yes, and the distribution between the invariant and the entire invariant path is one in the invariant path and two in the entire invariant.
I see. Yeah, the three hyperbolics in H2.
Right.
One is positive, the others are negative, you said squares.
Yeah. So that's why if you have a component of genus component of the real path of genus at least two, all the other components are necessarily spheric, so the square should be negative.
So then you'll have one. I see. So you must have one component of positive square.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. What are the consequences? What are the consequences of such an inequality?
Well, I don't know. So for me, and I think also for Grisha, this inequality is already a consequence. So it's for us it's an example of application of these considerations of simple Harnack curves and deformations of curves on gauge surfaces. So it's an example of statement one can get out of this considerations. Then probably this statement can be used for something else, but it's probably just one of possible examples of application. But it's, I think in principle, it's interesting to try to understand what one can say about the areas of components of the real part of a real K3 surface. And so it's, at least I think it's interesting to see that spheres are, in a sense, from this area point of view, are small. There are other inequalities one can write. There is another inequality in our paper, but the other inequality is, in a sense, easier than this one. So the other inequality is just a corollary of, once again, this game with signatures of invariant and anti-invariant path. But this inequality is really corollary. So I don't know how to deduce such an inequality just playing with linear algebra and this, with intersection form. So this is really corollary of this game with deformations of curves on K3 surfaces.
Yeah, there is another question actually in the chat. Mm-hmm. So do double cover surfaces of simple Harnack curves show any significance in terms of area or otherwise compared to other M curves?
Mm. Well, so
it would be a Harnack surface, right? And so it probably means that we have to look at this surface of genus 11 and the sphere, right?
So to stay in the framework of K3 surfaces, so we should simple Harnack curve. It's at least the topology is like this. So in principle, a simple Harnack curve in RP2 is, this notion contains more information than just this topology, right? So because as Grisha explained, simple Harnack curve also requires some special position with respect to the axis, because in the case of a plane, we play with a log K3 surface. But if we just look at the topology and we take the double covering, so we get this topology. So we have only two connected components, right? So one connected component of genus 10 and one sphere. And it's not really very special comparing to other situations. So this from the area of this sphere is smaller than the area of this component of genus 10. That's true, but I don't know any very special property from the point of view of these two areas of the surface. Right, Grish?
I don't know either, yeah.
But the inequality is true. So the fact that the area of the spherical component is smaller than the area of non-spherical component in this case, it's a corollary of the second inequality. I didn't write down explicitly, but it's true.
So, for one of the coveralls of the first, right? For the non-contractible one.
For this choice of But if we take the other
they're equal, right?
What was it?
The other probably no, right? Because for that as well, yeah. Sorry.
The other is In principle, formally speaking, the other lifting is not covered by our inequalities.
Because of the genus inequality? Or...
Because the component is not non-contractible.
Wait, I mean the one which is contractible with one component. So we have just two, surface of genus 11 and sphere.
No, if we have what I have wrote, so it's genus 10 and genus 0. So in this case, of course, it's discovered by the second inequality. The area of the sphere is smaller than the area of the non-spherical component, for sure. But for the second lifting, so if you have a torus and nine spheres, the torus is contractible in right. So it's so the polarization we see here is not non-contractible. So formally speaking, our inequality is not applicable.
May I ask a philosophical question?
Sure.
So you are able to talk about the areas because you have a non-vanishing holomorphic 2-0 form. You look at the real part, right? You are here.
Yes.
So before the discussion yesterday, day 2 days before, you are able to talk about areas because you have this magical fact. You have the curve, you project the real part, on the imaginary part, the map between them, area preserving somehow.
Right. Well, it was possible to speak about areas even in a sense without this fact. So because this fact was a way to say something about these areas, but it was possible to speak about areas because we had already a two form in
in the
complex torus.
Yeah, I was. Why did complex torus? Before we have just a curve, just complex curve, real and imaginary part of a complex curve. It wasn't a complex torus chain necessarily.
No, but in a sense, this C star square is also a K3 surface, but it's log K3 surface, right? But it has the poles, but nevertheless, it's kind of a simpler version of the K3 surface, just the plane.
How about
the same kind of form?
How about doing the same thing for this degree 4 surface by projecting real and complex parts some crazy way?
I think there will be only one, right? Then we can consider this map. So what would it be? It would be, we would need to present it as an integrable system kind of, right? As a fibration with Lagrangian torus fibers with singularities over a sphere, right? Which we can do sometimes, but it would be only one map, right? Because it's closed. Of course, it's more difficult to. But this is general phenomenon, right, philosophically, that closed Calabi-Yaus are much more difficult than those log toric Calabi-Yaus for which people have many results. And we have the same thing, right? So it was much easier to say something about this toric case than in the case of closed K3 philosophy. Well, at least,
So may I just finish recording and then you can continue maybe in informal discussions. I really would like to thank both of our speakers, Ilia Itenberg and Grigory Mikhalkin, for these great four lectures. And let's thank them again.